Right. Now we're on the subject of evil works. I'd like to say that you all know SimonHarris, and we've been colleagues for about 10 years when you joined evil works in 04, 05.
Yeah.
And I would say Simon's work has blossomed extremely well over that time. And here is an example of one of his pieces. I think it's from a few years ago. And I gave a hint as how I would start my questioning. And if I could explain the nature of my question, because I think it will help clarify things, is my previous show, Eagle Works, actually finished last night. And I was, if you notice, I did sneak off from the group crib early yesterday, and because there was a freelance creator who wanted to see the show, and so I went over, and he made a comment about one of my paintings, and he said that he had two readings of it. The first reading was one which he had when he knew nothing about the work. But when I explained to him about the origin of the work, he said, well, it's now a different painting. It's equally as good, the painting hasn't changed, but my reading of it is different. Now, one thing I'd like to sort of develop with Simon is the idea of appearance and content and origin. Because obviously everybody, in my opinion, who sees this piece will see a very beautiful appearance. But there's an old adage which says appearances aren't everything. Now, the artist, in my strong opinion, has the privilege of saying no to an audience. All I want you to feel about this work is the appearance. But I would actually like Simon to develop a kind of little speech about perhaps possible content and possible origin of this work. If I could now leave it over to you to discuss that.
Okay. You're absolutely right, this is from an older project of work, 2008. So it feels quite strange talking about work that's sort of that old, really. And it is a series, I think, that ended up with about 13 paintings in the end. And it all originated with Vermeer's Golden Bird earring. And as an image, I was very, very interested in the painting for a couple of reasons. And the one was because I felt, as an image, it was so overloaded. It had been so consumed. It was almost instantly recognisable. You mentioned the painting, and instantly people had a recollection of what that painting looked like. You know, it's a mouse mat, it's a film, it's a book, it's... Yet visually, I was very struck with the way the painting had been constructed, and I realised that my residual memory of it was actually not from the original image in itself. It was from facsimiles, and it was from how it had been presented, so I was sort of trying to garner some information about it. And visually, a couple of things struck me that when we think of the Girl of the Berlin, we think of it as a very seductively painted image, that there's a very fine attention to the detail and the blossoming and rose petals and lips and the glistening of the pearl. But actually, there's a lot of shorthand that goes in. So when you start to look at Harris collar. It's virtually just a slab of white paint that goes across. When you start to look at the dress, there's kind of just rough areas that are blocked in. And it's because visually, the painting leads you all round to how the face was working. But because of the way that the white sat on the kind of pictorial surface, there was a strange, once you actually acknowledged it, was that strange thing, that the inevitability of the illusion in painting, as soon as you put a mark over a solid ground, you created the depth of the field. And all of a sudden, these marks suddenly became dislocated from the image. It was sitting in its kind of its own space, and that is a device really intrigued me. And then as I kind of did further research into it, it's sort of a large suspicion that the background wasn't black originally, but in fact it was green. And it's through the years of explanation and the way that the paint has aged, it turned green, so that's why I started to get interested in it. So, you might then start to look at this painting and say, right, okay, what this doesn't look like the girl with the brown hair, and what does this have to do with it? And I was trying to develop or try to understand a language where I could activate these different types of space that were in that painting. And still trying to garner an almost intimacy the girl that Berlin kind of pretends or alludes to have it. So yeah, that was kind of the origins of this.
Thank you. Right, can I perhaps develop a point in as much as you describe the origin? I'm just wondering whether this surface is entirely to do with the girl with her hearing as an origin, or whether it can actually transfer and translate to perhaps other visual experiences that you perhaps had in life or been interested in. You described how intimate it was, because if you go to the Martin House in The Hague, I almost forgot the capital, it is not terribly big, is it? Mm-hmm. And it does have that very sort of calm, meditative. But I'm interested in the way it's affected you, and I think because a lot of people would just see it differently. A lot of people would just, oh yes, I want to a girl appearing, just an outline. But you've gone against outlines, and you've gone for a subject matter which you've discovered comes out of that painting, which perhaps very few people have discovered that, but you've discovered it, and you've developed it. So, can you actually say anything that where it's, in your experiences, it's translated from other areas of your visual investigation?
Yeah, I mean, it's quite interesting because whilst that's happening, I was kind of, I guess that really sparked this interest in this idea of scope, this idea of how we look at paintings or how we negotiate them. And I guess all my paintings derive from a pictorial given, from a pictorial reference, whether it's a photograph, whether it's another painting. It's usually been mediated in some form. But then I get quite interested in the way that the space is activated in that painting or in that individual. Sometimes experience, I kind of mentioned about the cinema. I think when we opened up, we're interested in cinema. And again, that's because pictorially there's something that happens, but there's also something that happens within space. You enter into a cinema. The lights go down, your vision tunnels to the screen, which glows off the glows from the wall, and you have a loss of self, and you enter into the narrative. And time changes, time dissolves, time becomes something different. And I guess sort of through the investigation of that, I went to some cinemas to talk to projectionists and how they went about. And suddenly it dawned on me that actually the time for the projectionist goes very differently to the time for the viewer in the auditorium. So that then couples with this idea of how images are consumed at the moment. They're very disposable, they're very mediated, they're very used to Instagram, Snapchats and things like this, where images get posted and then they dissolve and they stay out in this ether. So I wanted my paintings to do something very, very different. I wanted them to have that durative effect or that loss of yourself within it. But that idea within a pictorial space has been kind of theoretically quite problematic. It's been sort of really debunked from the beginning because of some of the issues that we've talked about. It's illusionary, it's not real, it lies, and it's not attaining its purity. And so I kind of went to it from a slightly different angle and sort of said, well, okay, if I acknowledge it's a lie, if I acknowledge that it's an illusion, if you enter into that space, you're consenting to go, you're consenting to that illusion. And that kind of freed me up really to start exploring the Victoria, what was happening in a way that wasn't referential to the kind of the object itself. And I guess I'm quoting a phrase now, but rather than it be an object of representation, it's an object of encounter.
But just to develop a point, you talked about general pictorial experience and pictorial interpretation of those experiences and how we sort of mediate them with the way we're presented with images from all sorts of different realms of our lives. Now this obviously is a painting which is so traditional, and what I think is almost magical is that you've actually managed to say to all this what theorists call hyperreality of cinema images and book images and whatever, and it's almost as if you step right back and say, I'm looking at all this, but I'm going to look at it from a painter's viewpoint, as though you're sort of painting, not painting a hyper-reality, but noting around all this hyper-reality and then thinking, well, this is interesting. So you were looking at the hyper-reality, then back at the traditional Vermeer image, and then doing your own thing in between. I mean, how do you feel about it? I mean, obviously you've got enormous craft skills in terms of painting. How important is the actual fact that you've done the painting of that, that mediates between Vermeer and our present day hyper-reality? How important is that?
That's a really interesting question. And a I think to approach that, I need to approach it from two slightly different directions. One is a picking up on a point that was made earlier, was about the relationship to the viewer. It's the kind of why you make it. You don't think of the viewer that you make for yourself, and I'd say that I'm very opposite to that. That's not my practice. I make for the viewer. The viewer is present with me through the entirety of the process, because I want to think, okay, how is the viewer going to be immersed in this painting? Because that's what I want. The importance of for me to do the painting come, I guess, twofold. One is to ask generous speech about the viewer, and it's about the viewer. There's a selfishness in it, and I paint it. I enjoy the materiality of painting. I enjoy making paintings. There's not kind of one aspect of it, from the laborious stretching of it to the monotonous layering of it, that I don't enjoy. I thoroughly love. But what also excites me is in this kind of age of consumption, this age of immediacy or disposable ability, that there's something that painting, something that is so obviously based on craft and tradition and history, still has an opportunity to talk within that. Still has a relevance, and that excites me.
Yeah, that was the point I was hoping you would reach. Although, obviously, a traditional way of doing things from, I don't know, 500 years or so, that you've chosen specifically because you're good at it, and I was just hoping I would perhaps tease out of you whether the painted surface has a privilege, or whether it is now, in these days, just another way of doing it, another different way of interpreting pictorially aspects of our lives, you know, as I say, hyper reality, and then Vermeer's image. I would say that you've managed to actually establish the painter's surface as a privileged one. How do you feel about that?
Awkward. Anyone who knows me will know that. I'm squirming. I treat the painted surface with a reverence. Whether that's a privilege or not, I don't know. But I certainly revere the painted surface. Yeah. I don't know that privilege here, because I think there's other ways that you can explore. I don't think this is the only way of exploring those tropes or those ideas. But for me, it's the most relevant, I guess.
Yeah, but what I meant by privilege is that the painted surface can do things in this way that I doubt whether a photograph-based surface could do. I mean, in my own work, I've done a lot of manipulated, altered photographs. I don't think I could use that language to achieve what this looks like. What I'm saying is, it's almost, painting is doing something that no other language or medium achieve. And I think that's what I'm trying to say. I think that's what that makes this special.
Is it something in that sort? Because I know that you have this tremendous bother of photographing your work, so actually it almost can't exist in a magazine or catalogues. It's really tricky to get the quality of this work in reproduction, isn't it?
Yeah.
So it, that kind of feeds into this idea of it being like a privileged or a different kind of situation, isn't it? It won't go into the mediated work. You have to come and see it and stand in front of it and encounter it physically.
Yeah. Well, that's to some extent that's really. I guess it's the difficulty that I have with privilege, that idea. And I guess it is because to have the opportunity to experience it does become, I guess, it's not available to everybody. Privilege. But it is, yes, it is that idea that you can only gain that experience through the actual object itself, the facsimile when reproduce that. You can't replicate that encounter. So that encounter is between that person and the object. Is of that, and you know, and that creates its own reality in some respects. That becomes its own kind of virtual reality. So it has all of these kind of references. I mean, the intriguing thing that happens with some of the paintings is that they get referenced to other mediums. So. Those that knew that this was part of the fine art staff show that took all the art gallery, it came down halfway through this week, so I had to go over and collect it. It was a good opportunity to then bring that in and then bring it here. And we were carrying it across the ring road, and a passerby said, "Oh, do you mind, because we haven't wrapped it. Do you mind if I have a look?" And I said, "Yeah, sure." So he's kind of walking alongside, looking at the painting, and it was quite complimentary. He said, "Did you do that on a computer?" And I said, "No, it's all by hand." And he was like, "Really?" I've had people who thought that their transfers that have been stuck onto the canvas, and I guess the one that I'm most pleased about is I had a painting that was part of the West Midlands Open, and at the end of the private view, one of the legislators was going around and spoke to the chief curator who was having a conversation at the time and said, "Where's the plug to turn the painting off?" Because they thought that it was lit from behind and it was a light box. And I was kind of, That's fantastic. So that kind of idea of, and I guess that comes from that cinematic reference or that glow from within.
How important is ritual, or use the word ritual, in your pieces? Because having seen you start working and seen you work around, I get a feeling that's really important to you. Wouldn't like to, even though you could make marks straight away on a surface that you could just bring something in and say, right, start, that wouldn't satisfy. I mean, you could do it if we. How important is the ritual?
Absolutely tremendous. Because there's, and I think this goes back to the sort of comment, there's no aspect of it I don't enjoy. But It always starts from a kind of, as I said, a pictorial given. So I'll have something there that's caught my eye, like it really interests me. And sometimes that may be three or four images that I'm playing around with. They're all doing similar things. They're all doing that little something that I want to look into. So it'll then start with, when I'm stretching out the canvas, I'm thinking about the images. I'm starting to prepare the surfaces, and then starting off with this little drawing, very small, and usually that's quite a figurative drawing. But that's, I'm thinking about how that space is working. And I'm kind of editing and refining decisions that are going on through each of those processes. So by the time I come to the canvas, that kind of image is already gone through this process of abstraction, in terms of how I'm thinking about the space. And I'm no longer thinking about the space in terms of the figurative givens that are out of it, but of ways that I can kind of make that And sometimes that there are lines of representation that are left in it, because that's the only way for it to work. But yeah, so that kind of ritual, that process of going through it is tremendously important.
Would you say, because it was two key words you said when you were describing Mia's career and the effect it had on you, and the effect it had on me, is that calm and meditative effect. I think, you know, what David's just said, that kind of process, the quite long drawn out process, reflects that kind of response to, not response, but how you actually go about and what you want to get out of the painting. You've got that calm sort of approach, whereas mine's more instantaneous, you know, I've got to do it now, but that is all.
Sometimes I wish I could hear it more.
No, I mean, that is kind of the end result, that calm and meditative effect. In a way, that's what you want, isn't it? Surely, because it reflects the process. Reflect. If you go back to the girl with the pearl earring, it's got that kind of effect on us.
I guess, yeah. I mean, I get. I feel over the course of these paintings, I've had to address lots of issues that I find difficult. So the idea of, you know, beautiful, calm, tranquil. It's all words that make me uncomfortable, and I agree. You know.
Yeah, but you know, maybe that's the kind of you can't get away from. No,
I've had to sort of face it. I've had to face it and say, okay. But I think for me, it's this idea, and I guess all those words come from is this idea of being immersed in space.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's not being immersed in the space as we would say a kind of Renaissance painting, in the way that takes us into Victorian space. Or immersed in the way that we would say be immersed in Rothko. Mm-hmm. Is that, do you know what I mean?
Yeah. I think the words that Simon used probably were a little bit kind of, I'm not saying they're wrong, but I mean they're a descriptive term, aren't they? That is a general, generic term. So, immersed, I suppose, is probably a lot more descriptive of the process reflecting the
end. Yeah, yeah. And I guess, you know, to some extent, if I want the viewer to be immersed in the work, I have to be fully immersed in it. It has to be, because whilst just being a man, I guess I am the viewer.
Mm. You see, I mean, you're immersed over a period of time. I'm immersed over a shorter period of time, and I just wonder what that kind of difference is.
It's interesting. I guess it takes that much to, I think, to trigger the emotion is quite a tricky thing. I don't think it's a given. I think there's devices that you can use them to sort of hint at it, but I guess to some extent it has to be quite a process of going through to make it. And I guess, I mean, a lot of it is, you know, I'm very dependent on the kind of process is very dependent on dry times, and so, you know, to some extent as we've gone on with the week, there's more and more work sort of materialising, and as I said to you, this was one of 13 paintings.
Do you think it'd be, if somebody could come in today and say, oh, I know you do that every day. you just need to do this, isn't it?
Yeah.
Would work, the kind of work, because I think there's a work ethic isn't there? There is this kind of, you know, and actually a lot of it is hard labour. When I've seen you working, it is scrubbing down the surface and letting it dry, and, you know, day after day.
Yeah.
If somebody came in and said, oh, you don't know, there you go, would it work for you? But there's that
history, is it what people don't know, is the history of that painter, the painter themselves.
Well, it's hidden in your painting, because it's much more evident in the other, everyone else's paintings and stuff. So, I think somebody could come in and pick it apart and say, oh, they did that, and then they did. The thing about yours is for all that labour,
Who
were kind of
art
design professionals or whatever.
Yeah. But you're saying about the viewer as well, and I'm thinking about your service and the work that was in here last week or the week before. You were playing with Matt and Ross and in between. The viewer is almost necessarily, as soon as you're standing between, you see yourself in it. And is that very important to you as well? Or?
Yeah, that's hugely important. Yeah. I'm kind of glad you asked that in some respects, because that becomes part of that process of you actually acknowledging how you're looking at it differently. Mm-hmm. So when you're seeing the reflection of yourself, you're looking at one surface, but as soon as you then enter into the space, you've almost had to refocus your eyes and to bodily move yourself to enter into.
I mean, I was reading recently an article about working on a small surface, and about that intimacy that you have as a viewer, because you're taking the whole sort of small surface in. In a way, that's the same thing, isn't it? Because you're having the viewer intimacy, because they're having to deal with a number of things, that reflective issue, and as well as the image.
I like the idea of the scale of the work, being large, and normally we dissociate that kind of sublime, but actually bringing it down to this kind of small instrument, seductive moment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, it's a paradox, really, isn't it? That is a big painting, if we think of what a small painting is.
Yeah.
And you're trying to get the feeling of what people get from the intimacy of the small painting in a big. So you're trying to do the opposite and work, which is an immediate problem, isn't it?
It is, but I think it comes from the answer comes from the question that Maggie asked about. Somebody came in and said, right, this is how you can achieve that in 24 hours. I wouldn't be interested in that because I wouldn't have to struggle. I wouldn't have had to. Do you know what I mean?
And would be a pain.
Almost, but it's. I mean, it goes back to, I think, you mentioned this, Christian mentioned this. It has to be. We have to make it complicated. Mm. There has to be a complication in it, where it's not just guilt. We have to think our way through. We have to make our way through.
And it has to be hard.
And it has to be hard.
Yeah.
It has to be damn hard.
Mm. Well, it is problem solving, isn't it? Yeah. A painting is about continual problem solving.
Yeah.
You do something that doesn't work, how are you going to change it? What are you going to do next?
And we don't actually like that, really. I mean, we don't like problem solving. We don't like think when things go wrong or when overcome things. But we do.
Because then we're going
to work it. It's like that. It's a discussion, isn't it?
Yeah.
And it's also, it's not forgetting as much as you learn. So, Christian said he looks at parts of his painting and he's like, how did I do that? And I have to say, with my paintings, at times I look at some of it and I think, how do I come up against that problem again? And I've had that before, how did I do that? I can't quite remember.
Yeah. So, and equally the moment when something happens, you're like, oof.
Yes, yeah.
Got it.
It's magic, isn't it?
Yeah.
The moment is magic. And if it isn't magic, you've got to keep going. Yeah. It's got to have
Yes, you've got to, that's where it comes in, that selfish moment in the studio. And so, yeah, so it's addictive.
I'd like to ask some of you guys actually, because I think it's interesting. Obviously, your paintings, how long did it normally take?
Quite a while.
I mean, you're on 12-week programs, those of you that are on the VA. Would you, after this book, would you imagine you would just set up and say, right, I'm going to make some work now, and it's going to take me, this painting's going to take me the whole of the semester to do, and at the end of it, that's what will be happening in one piece of work. Because that's what Simon would have to do.
Yeah, yeah.
You have to re-enroll
at the end. I find that really hard. Because I have so many ideas going on at the same time, so it is difficult to just go at one thing and keep going at it methodically.
Yeah.
I would find it really hard.
But you see, I mean, the difference is that Simon, for example, has been through all that BA, etc. to get into the place where he's at now. So I wouldn't have necessarily known at the time of the BA that this was kind of a process that, you know, somebody that's due the first year of the BA, would you take 3 months to do one page and you'd say, that'd be ridiculous. Possibly.
Time there used to be the Hans Brinker budget trophy, and it's open to second and third years. We selected to go. And funny enough, it was about cinema, but it was very literal, it was a pencil inside. It was a big pencil, it was probably about 6 foot by 4 foot. And I suddenly, about 3/4 of the way through, decided that what I needed to incorporate into this pencil was the velvetiness of the chairs. So I'd looked at a kind of visual shorthand that I could do, and I couldn't do it in my head. So I got this red wool and I started stitching this red wool onto these. So I unraveled the bottom of the paint. I took about a day just to do a line. And so this painting then ended up taking virtually the whole semester, and I didn't get the opportunity to go to the Hans Brinker trophy because the painting wasn't finished. So I think I was always, you know, the painting takes as long as it kind of needs to take. So unfortunately, the lecturers that I had were supportive enough that they were kind of, yeah, let's go for it.
But it was a journey, you were learning all the way along.
Yeah,
as long as you're doing that, forever, if it's long, because I'm getting the reward out of it.
Mm-hmm. Well, you're
enjoying that.
You do learn different things by. It's like saying it's running, and you say, well, it's 100 yards in a marathon.
Yeah.
You learn very different things on a marathon than you do on 100 yards. It's both of them are running, both of them have got absolute experts in them, but you can't say by doing loads and loads of 100 yards, I can do a marathon. It's a very different thing, and it takes a certain, I think as a student you should be thinking, well, I've done a lot of 100 yards here, I should try a half a mile or a triple jump or something, because I think if you keep repeating that 100 yards, yes, you'll start to do it quite well, but you're not seeing what 200 yards is like, you're not seeing what a triple jump's like, you're not seeing what a marathon's like, and I think that's what you're talking about. I think you should have more approaches, because you'll surprise yourself by having that.
And I think I just want to sort of answer to Jack's. So it was just saying you'd like to go to work on one piece because you've got all of these ideas you've got. And I kind of recognise that because whilst I'm working on this, this isn't a single fixed idea, it's in flux. As the paintings develop, there are other influences that go into it. So there's kind of, as I say, to some extent, that pictorial given or that image, it's merely a tool, it's a vehicle to bring in all of these other ideas and these ways of exploring. But again, you know, the message from this week there's no single correct answer to it.
No.
I think there is maybe a sort of a kind of idea about being studio fit.
Yeah.
You know, that actually, it's very hard. I suspect everybody's found it quite hard to be in for 5 days.
Yeah, I'm really tired.
For 5 days in the studio, it's not something you do very often. You think it's all going to be, oh, I'm just going to paint for 5 days. How lovely, you know. Mm. Actually, kind of concentration and thinking that's going on in those 5 days is very different to a normal 5 days. And I suspect a lot of you have gone home very tired in the evenings or have struggled at different points to keep going.
Very intense concentration.
Yeah.
You arrive with a plan.
But gradually, I think you kind of feel the fitness. But I think it's a kind of fitness that you build.
Yeah.
So if you do a week like this, the next week you find it easier in the week until it becomes you can't live without it. Yeah.
But I think what's nice about that as well is your ideas or your way you operate becomes more and more intuitive.
Mm.
And I think that analogy to studio fit is excellent. You don't make so much. You don't, you find that you can make those decisions quicker
And almost it becomes a bit more unconscious. And I think sometimes people worry about it when they get to that point. They're thinking, God, I'm not ripping my hair out.
Yeah.
I think Amy, bring you into it, is a really good example of that. You know, that actually, within what, I don't know, 3 or 4 weeks before the degree show, you
change
your whole project around. And you just went into that space, but you got so kind of studio fit, to use the term, that you were ready to do it. You just went into that space and you were performing. And I wasn't kind of observing for 5 minutes, but I don't think you were struggling at that stage mentally. I think you just knew your body was for what you think. But did you feel that?
Well, I'm just sort of chatting about the project. I was a bit stressing, but
about
getting that frame of mind, you sort of
like
got an action plan.
Mm.
You just go with it,
But I think to achieve what you did in the space of time that you did, had you not been studio fit, that could have taken the course of a semester, if not two.
Yeah.
So it's quite interesting.
Well, I think we can wind up the talk up now and then.